Our God is great and greatly to be praised. Come on, somebody. Our God is great and greatly to be praised. I'm going to say it one more time. Our God is great and greatly to be praised. His name is above all names. And the Bible says that the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. We greet you this morning in the only name that matters, and that is the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Are you aware of that name? The songwriter says, there's a name I love to hear. I love to sing this word. It sounds like music in mine ear, the sweetest name on earth. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ on behalf of our First Lady, our deacons, our deaconess, our ministers, and our entire Macedonia church family. For those of you that are joining us live now, we greet you again in Jesus' name. We've come not to sit back, but we've come to lift our hands. We've come to exalt the name of the Lord. Christina McMillan and Tamaya Oates are dancing for us today. And I pray that you join in with them. Encourage yourself in the Lord. How many of you know every now and then you got to do this? Come on, somebody. You can't let what's going on the external get next to what's going on in the internal. For those of you who are just joining us, I invite you to turn to Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 through 34 from the New King James Version. And after they finish, I'll come forth with this morning's sermon. Those of you that are with us can have a seat in the house of the Lord. Come on, let's give him, let's give God glory. Celebrate the giftedness in Jemiah and Christina. Let me remind you that David's own army turned against him. But the Bible says that David encouraged himself in the Lord. And sometimes when trouble is coming at you from every direction and the enemy is trying to make you feel like you've done something wrong, you've got to encourage yourself. You can't wait on others to celebrate you. You can't wait on others to pat you on the back. Sometimes you got to look at God and encourage yourself in the Lord. From the book of Jeremiah, Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 through 34. And let me tell you, I've been preaching long enough to know that when the Lord changes the sermon, that there's a deposit that has to be made in someone's spirit. So it is my prayer, as I've been obedient to him, that you would open your hearts and minds to be receptive to the word of the Lord. Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 through 34. I'm reading from the New King James Version. Behold, the days are coming, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, my covenant which they broke. My covenant which they broke. My covenant which they broke. Though I was a husband to them, says the Lord. But this is the new covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No more shall every man teach his neighbor and every man his brothers, saying, know the Lord, for they all shall know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them, says the Lord. And here it comes. For I will forgive their iniquity, and their sin I will remember no more. Behold, the days are coming, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel. I want to talk this morning about a covenant-making and a covenant-keeping God. A covenant-making and a covenant-keeping God. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, we surrender ourselves to you completely, to you, Lord. My mind, my body, and my spirit. I yield my total being to you, Lord. I am your instrument. I pray that you would use me in any manner that brings your name glory, honor, and praise. Speak a word in this house. Touch our hearts and minds. Touch our hearts and minds. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. You may have your seats in the presence of the Lord. Congratulations. You landed a new job. The job is everything you have ever hoped for. You had a chance to sit down and discuss with your new employer your benefit package, your wages, and everything that is expected of you. Your employer went on and went as far to include all the details of the contract so you will have clear expectations of what your employer will provide and what is expected of you. In the end, you signed the contract, consenting to keeping your end of the agreement. You promised to work a certain amount of hours each week. You promised to be on time. You promised to fulfill the job description outlined in your contract. And you were told that you will have performance evaluations to measure your success. Likewise, your employer promised a compensation package, stay with me, and promised to provide you with all the resources needed for exemplary job performance. The two of you, employee and employee, signed the contract and you started work. Things went well, Deacon Poe, until you had your first performance evaluation. You were fully committed to honoring and upholding your end of the contract that you signed. You got off to a good start. However, as time progressed, you started reneging on your promises. You started falling short, like we all do. You started being a few minutes late each day. You didn't always work the minimum amount of hours you committed to work. Your work performance was less than acceptable. The bottom line is, and I hate to tell you this, but you broke the contract. You didn't keep your end of the bargain. You failed to honor the agreement that you signed. Your employer gave you numerous warnings, but you didn't show any signs of improvement. Finally, you were called to the office and your employer sat down to begin your performance review. Your employer reviewed the contract you originally signed. And bullet by bullet, your employer went over all of the areas in which you have failed. You didn't live up to your end of the contract. In the meantime, Deacon Fullwood, your thoughts are all over the place. You start asking yourself, will this be my last day at work? And there's a word that you don't want to say out loud, but the truth is, that word is on the forefront of your mind. F-I-R-E-D. Fire. No one wants to hear that word. Will you get a second chance, despite the fact you've been warned again and again? You know within your heart you don't deserve another chance, but somewhere in your mind you're hoping that at least they will have mercy. The relationship has been one-sided. They kept their end of the agreement, but you didn't keep yours. Are you with me? You've been provided with a place to work, a stress-free environment, the tools and training that you would need to do a great job, yet you failed. You defaulted on the contract that you signed. After the consultation and the performance review, your employer makes the decision to renew your contract. Renew your contract. You hadn't been coming to work on time. You've taken advantage of your employer's mercy and grace. But yet, your employer, Reverend Rasmus, decides to renew your contract. In fact, not only does the employer say, I'm going to renew your contract, but I'm also going to act just like you've never had a record with us. I wish I had somebody to talk to me. In other words, I'm going to put your past in the past. Forget about your past work performance and give you a fresh start despite your shortcomings. Give you a fresh start despite your shortcomings. Give you a fresh start despite your shortcomings. And for those of you who are not giving God praise or celebrating the fact that God gives us fresh starts despite our shortcomings, I dare you to look back in the rearview mirror and count the times that you have fallen short. Yet God, Perry, keeps giving us fresh starts, new beginnings. Somebody said, Pastor, I'm not following you. Let me just remind you that last night when you went to bed, you didn't have a guarantee. Yet you would see another day. But the Lord has given you a fresh start despite your sinful ways, despite your shortcomings. Pastor, where'd you get that introduction from? I made it up. I made it up as a way of showing you as an example from the world, a real life situation. Are y'all with me? And what the employee would have never expected was to receive mercy. receive grace when you're sitting there not knowing what you're going to hear. Whether your employment has been terminated or not. But then your employer looks you in the eyes and says, despite your past, despite your failed job performance, we are going to give you another chance. We're going to tear up your old contract, rewrite a new contract, and act just like you are a new employee. Brothers and sisters, in a real sense, you were the covenant breaker. The covenant was made between you and your employee, and you defaulted. Isn't that a picture of the background of our text? In case you are not aware, let me help you. Deaconess Fullwood, that tends to be Israel's story. They kept making commitments. They kept accepting God's covenants. And the truth is, the covenants of God are always one-sided. Now, somebody's saying, Pastor, why would you say the covenants of God are always one-sided? Because the truth is, God is the one who upholds, who keeps his agreement. And we are the ones who keep letting him down. Now, I wish I had about five folk that'll celebrate the fact that God is faithful, even when we are unfaithful, that God keeps his end of the agreement, even when we let him down. And yet we hear him in this text saying through the prophet Jeremiah, I will make a new covenant. Whoa, Pastor, what do you mean? Because the old covenant, I'm going to preach in a minute, was conditional. Now I know some of y'all are saying, what do you mean by it? Was the old covenant was conditional. It was always, Rachel, based on some contingency. What do you mean? God says, if Israel will obey me, if Israel will hearken to my words, then I will. All right, did you hear it? God is saying that my blessings in the old covenant are contingent upon your walking upright and doing what I have told you to do. Now, Brenda, I want to pause right here because I want to let you know this morning that if we were still living under the law, oh, I feel this thing this morning, and if our presence here was predicated, or rather contingent upon our faithfulness to God, I would be preaching to empty pews. Y'all don't hear me. In fact, there wouldn't be anyone here because I couldn't preach. Because the Bible says we have all sinned, come on somebody, and fallen short of the glory of God rather than celebrating the fact that we are covenant keepers. Let's acknowledge that we have been covenant breakers. Pastor Henry, I dare you to call me. I've been in the Baptist church all my life. I was born in this church. I was raised. My daddy brought the windows in the old sanctuary. And you're going to tell me I'm a covenant breaker? Pastor Henry. And God, 2,000 years later, fulfilled this covenant in the personality of Jesus Christ. And we're going to talk about that in a minute. But now, you know, in studying, you have to ask the question. Because anytime you get something new, you ought to wonder, well, what happened to the old one? Are y'all with me? God is not just in the business of making a new covenant. But in this case, he made a new covenant. He didn't revise the old covenant. He completely destroyed the old covenant and allowed them to walk under a new agreement. Pastor Henry, you mean to tell me that even though Israel had sinned again and again and again and again, that God gave them a new opportunity, are y'all with me, to experience a new covenant with him? Pastor Henry, you going to preach? I'm going to preach in a minute. I want you to see it. Well, Pastor, where is it? It's right there in the text. Because God says, behold, the days are coming, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant, read it right here, with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah. Listen, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by their hands and led them out of Egypt, my covenant which they broke. I'm going to sound like a broken record here. My covenant which they broke. Genevieve, I heard it again and again and again. My covenant which they broke. My covenant that I kept, but my covenant which they broke. They agreed to do what was right. They agreed to hearken to the voice of God. They agreed to keep the commandments that God had put in place. But God said they broke it. Pastor, where did they agree? I'm glad that you asked. Because if you remember, as we fast forward, are y'all with me? You remember when God called Moses up to Mount Sinai. And that's where he gave what we call the Sinai covenant. Stay with me, I'm going somewhere. And you remember that God wrote the Ten Commandments, etched them out with his finger on two tablets of stone. After God had finished, the Bible says, you got to hear this, that the people said, we will do everything that the Lord, that's Bible, has told us to do. We will do everything that the Lord has told us to do. We will do it. We just heard it. We heard the commandments. He gave it to us. He even wrote them on stone. And now we know what is expected of us. The 10 laws, the 10 commandments that God has put in place. And one verse later, they say, we will do everything that God has told us to do. Can I get somebody to talk to me? Reverend Darlena Brown, just a few chapters later, help me somebody. The people looked for Moses and couldn't find him. Y'all don't hear me? In fact, they asked Aaron, where is Moses? He's been up there with God too long. Now remember, they just made a commitment. We will do everything that God has told us to do. But in the absence of Moses, they became impatient. They wanted to see their God. Y'all didn't hear me? So they summoned Aaron to build, a golden calf. Help me, somebody. So they would have a God that they could see, a God that they could touch. You know, I'm trying to figure out, since y'all not helping me, how is it that you can make a covenant in one chapter and say we will do everything that the Lord has told us to do. And just a few chapters later, when it seems like God has disappeared, help me somebody, you are ready to build a golden calf. How is it that we can make a promise in May and break it in June? How is it at the beginning of this pandemic, we say, God, if you get us out of this, we'll commit to you, we'll commit to your ways. And a year later, I wish I had somebody to help me. We're doing the same things that we used to do. How is it that we can make commitments to God in worship and Sunday night we're breaking covenants? How is it that we say, God, I promise to be faithful if you get me out of this dilemma. But as soon as you get out, you leave God behind and move forward as though you don't need him again. Now I see about five folk doing this, but this message is about transparency. This message is about honesty. This message is about admitting that you have failed to keep your end of the bargain. So God says, I will, Reverend Caldwell, make a new covenant. Not the same covenant that I made with your forefathers, because you broke that one. Come on, somebody. You broke that one. The New Living Translation says, they broke that covenant. The Amplified Version says, although I was their God, they broke that agreement. And what almost made me get out of my chair was the message, Eugene Peterson. And he said, they broke that covenant even though I did my part as their master. Now I know some of y'all are still waking up because it's early in the morning, but I want to pause right here. And I want at least five of you to celebrate the fact that God has kept his part. Come on. Now, if I had to ask you to stand on your feet for me, then you have every right to sit down. But let's be honest, Brother Carr, God has kept his part. I wish I had somebody to help me. In fact, somebody will say hallelujah. God has kept his part. Oh, I want to let it go, but I feel it. God has kept his part. Even when we walked in disobedience, God has kept his part. Even when we made commitments that we didn't keep, God has kept his part. My covenant, which they broke, the message says they broke that covenant even though I did my part as their master. Now go back for a minute to the New King James. I'm going to teach and then I'm going to preach. Because here's what God said. And the language makes you almost want to cry. Because God said, look, here it is. He says, though I was a husband to them. He talks about a relationship. And he uses that metaphor to establish, though I was a husband to them, they failed me. They broke their commitment. They committed. You know, I'm just reminding you of what they said. Pastor, tell us one more time, Bonnie, here's what they said. When God had finished what's called the Sinai covenant, or the covenant that was given at Mount Sinai, they said, we will do everything. I wish I had somebody to talk to me. Everything that the Lord has told us to do. We will do everything that the Lord has told us to do. But as soon as the tide turned, as soon as another day came, as soon as they returned to normalcy, uh-oh, 2021, we were returning to normalcy, even though I don't think we ever go back to where we were. But things were smoothing out. Come on, somebody. We started taking off our mask. And I'm not talking about our physical masks. Oh, y'all missed that. We started getting back to normalcy. God has allowed me. He has spared my life. And I've come through this. So let me get back to the norm. And God is saying this morning, what about the commitment? What about the agreement? You said, God, if you will deliver me, I'll never use again. You said, God, if you heal my body, I'm going to preach it again. I'll never go back to that. You said, God, if you straighten out my finances, I commit, to doing everything you say. Somebody said, I wish I'd have stayed in bed this morning. I didn't want to hear this. But yet, in spite, Dr. Oaks, of their unfaithfulness, God proved himself faithful. Anybody want to celebrate? A faithful God? A faithful God? Anybody in the house know he's faithful? Come on, somebody. Anybody in the house know he's faithful? Faithful, Abraham said, is he that promised? And then he gave us, Perez, some promises. Y'all ought to read it. It's a good book to read. Come on, somebody. He gave them some promises, and I want to deal with three of them because I want you to hear them loud and clear. Are y'all with me? God says, my covenant which they broke, though I was a husband of them, saith the Lord, but this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. Uh-oh, I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. Good God, I wish I had somebody to help me. Can I tell you, I have reached the point that I make a lot of notes. I do. Always, the staff knows I've got notes everywhere. But my problem is, I write the notes, and then I can't find or remember where I put the note. Oh, y'all didn't have, and somebody else said, he's getting too old. All of that's going on. Can I talk to somebody in here? But God says, look, I'm going to fix this thing for you. I'm no longer going to force you to try to read what's on stone. Can I get a witness? And even when you don't have this book with you, I wish I had somebody to help me. God says, I'm going to write it on the tables of your heart. Can I get a witness? Has anybody ever gone through something and you needed a word and didn't have your Bible close, but all of a sudden God spoke? God is my refuge and my strength, a very present help. I wish I had somebody help me. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? No weapon formed against me shall prosper. God reminds us, I have put my word here. You broke the agreement. You broke the agreement. I wrote my word on stone. I gave you 10 commandments to live by. You said you were going to keep them, but you failed me. So God says, here I am with a new covenant. Are y'all with me? Deacon Post, somebody is asking, Pastor, break it down. I didn't give the media minister my 3 points, but I'm going to share them with you. Notice what God says. He says, look, I will put my law in their minds and in their hearts. God says, I'm going to make my law internal. Now, if you had gotten that, somebody ought to have to say it, amen. God says, I'm going to put it here. Put it in your heart. So when you walk around, you'll hear me. When you find yourself at the bottom of the barrel, you'll hear me. Anybody ever heard him? And I'll bring those things to your remembrance. Wow. I will put my law in their minds. I'm going to preach in a minute. And in their heart. You got to remember that the old law was written on stone. The problem with the stones was they represented our stony hearts. Pastor, you walked away from the camera. The folk on Facebook couldn't see you because I wanted to demonstrate to you how many times we walked away from God. And yet, despite our rebellion, despite our disobedience, God says, I will give you a new covenant. This time I'm not going to write it on stone, but I'm going to put it here. Wow, wow. So he makes his law internal. And next he told them, he says in verse 33, the B and C portion, he told them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Now, Rem Caldwell, what you've got to hear is, that's the same thing that he said to Abraham in the Abrahamic covenant. Now, some of y'all are saying, well, if that's the case, then why did he make a new covenant? Now, here's what you're not going to want to hear, and those of you who listen to via Facebook need to get this, because in my research, I learned that once you broke a covenant, in the Old Testament, it means the deal was done. null and void. Because a contract or a covenant was a binding agreement. Now, you're not going to like this next slice, but I just heard God. That's what marriage was intended to be. Oh, I see. But God said, you broke your part of the agreement. But guess what? Rather than holding you hostage, I'm going to liberate you from that covenant and establish, come on, Antoine, a new covenant. Can I get somebody to help me? Pastor, you need to help us. Tell us what it means to get rid of the old. God says, I'm going to rip it up. Because it's null and void. You didn't keep it. You lied to me and said that you were going to honor the very things that I told you to do. Can I get a witness? That is why you were down. But when you got back on your feet, you reneged on your promises. But God said, I am going to look at you like I've never looked at you before. I'm going to forget your past and give you a new chance to be my people, and I shall be your God. Can I get a witness? I have to be honest and tell you, if you were my children and if you had what habitually broken my promises and my commandments, I would have told you to get out the door and don't look back. But I'm glad this morning that we serve a God who looks beyond our faults and sees our every need. Is there anybody in the house glad this morning that rather than justice, God gives us mercy? Rather than justice, God gives us grace. Grace. God establishes a new relationship with them. I will be your God, and you will be my people. Whoa. You know, can I talk? My grandmother used to talk about feeding people out of a long-handled spoon. And that is when you had defaulted or you had transgressed or did something against another individual. What that person was saying is, I'm not going to give you the liberty, come on somebody, to get close to me again. Can I get a witness? So the longer the spoon, the further the distance that I'll be from you. But Deacon Jenkins, somebody ought to give God praise that he does not minister us out of a long-handled spoon, but rather than distancing himself, he invites us to come a little closer. He invites us to come back to him. He invites us to come and draw nigh to him. You broke the old covenant. You didn't keep your end of the bargain. But yet God said, y'all don't hear me. I'm going to preach in a minute. My law in you. I'm going to put my spirit in you. So that when you think that you can go the opposite way, my spirit, I wish y'all had somebody to help me, will not allow you to go but so far. I taught for the Hammond Creek Association 2 weeks ago, and I won't bring up the ordeal, but we talked about eternal security. Young lady said to me, I respectfully disagree with you. I said, it's okay, but I respectfully stand on God's word. Can I get a witness? She said, a man can turn himself from God. I said, you're right. A man can. But I said, a man who has the Spirit of God living in him may turn from God. But the Holy Ghost, y'all don't hear me, will bring you back. Now some of you can't say amen because you don't know what it means to be brought back. But if you've ever made a wrong turn and you could feel God, come back here with your hard-headed self. I love you too much to let you go astray. Come back here. Come back here. That's what Paul meant when he said nothing. Y'all don't hear me? Shall be able to separate me from the love of God. Somebody ought to give God praise. Nothing, no height, no depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God. God says, I love you too much to let you stay there. I love you too much to let you stay there. I will put my word in your heart. I will establish a new relationship. I haven't got to my third point yet. With you, you'll be my people and I will be your God. Then God says something, Deacon Mitchell, that makes me want to shout. Good God from Zion. God says, I will forgive your iniquity and your sins. I will remember no more. Can I get a witness? Man will not let you forget who you used to be. Man will remind you of all the things you used to do. But God said, help me somebody. I will remember your sins no more. You don't have to say, God, I'm sorry, once you repent. After repentance, the Lord said that I'll cast your sins in a sea of forgiveness. Help me somebody. And in this text, he said, I will remember your sins no more. 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 Can I ask you a question? Why do you keep fishing for what God has forgotten? Uh-oh. I didn't write it. He wrote it. Deacon Simms, he says, I will remember your sins no more. What he was saying is, I can't remember them. Now, you know me, I just don't let things go. I got to have an understanding. It's my job to get an understanding. I said, God, help me to understand how you can forget, because we don't. How can, he said, well, you need to take them to a hill called Calvary and remind them that Jesus paid it all. Can I get a witness? So rather than looking at your sins, God looks at his son. Y'all didn't hear me? Rather than looking at your past, God looks at his son. Rather, Brother Green, than looking at our future, God looks at his son. The nail-scarred hands at Calvary paid for our sins in full. I will make, I'm not closing, a new covenant. I will put my word here in your heart. I'll renew the relationship that I have with you. I know what you've done. I know you failed. I know you've defaulted. But guess what? You're still my people. And I am still your God. I will forgive your iniquity and I will remember your sins no more. How many times have we made commitments and failed? How many times have we made commitments and failed? And yet God says, I'm going to take that covenant that I made with you, completely discard it, eradicate it, get rid of it. And I'm going to make a new one. This time it's going to be in your hearts. This time it's going to be internal rather than external. This time I'm going to renew my relationship with you. And you will be my people. And I will be your God. I read something as I close about a young man who was a college student. It's an amazing story. First semester in college, he lived about 3 hours from his home. And he was excited about being in school. And one afternoon, Barney, as he was making the exit up the hill that led back to his dormitory, the car started to jerk. Finally, the engine stalled. And he realized there was something wrong. He raised the hood, remembering his father was a mechanic who worked at the bus station for the transit authority. He checked the battery, looked at everything, and said, everything looks like it should. I can't believe this has happened to me. Finally, he called AAA. His parents had signed him up for AAA. The tow truck came. And he said, just get it back to the dormitory. I called my daddy. He's a mechanic. And when he gets off work, he'll come. And he'll take care of it. The driver took the car back, offloaded it at the dormitory. All of his friends says, man, what happened? He said, just stopped. His father had worked 8 hours. But he told his son, says, as soon as I end my shift, I'm coming. I'm coming, and I'll take care of the problem. When the father arrived, it took about 5 minutes to look the car over and told the son, get back in the car. I got it from here. The son looked at his daddy and said, Daddy, please tell me what's wrong with the car. He says, son, the car is out of gas. You got to hear it. The son was so embarrassed. But the father said to the son, this will always be between the two of us. I'll never mention this again. 2 weeks later, the boy went home for break. The family was having dinner. Uncles and aunts were all gathered around, and the boy sat there nervous because he thought, sure, that his daddy was going to tell about the experience of him having given out of gas. He kicked his father under the table, and after everything was over, he looked at his dad and said, Dad, I thought sure you were going to make a joke out of it. He says, I told you, I'll never mention that again. Pastor Henry, why in the world did you tell us the story about a young boy giving out of gas and his father saved him from embarrassment? Our Father saves us this morning. I won't ever remind you of what I've done for you. It's between us. I will treat you as though I don't even remember it. Wouldn't it be nice, Dr. Oaks, to live in a world where people would treat us like God? Wouldn't it be nice to live in a world where people would treat us like the Father treated his Son? I'll never bring that up again. I know you were embarrassed. I know you were embarrassed and ashamed. but you called me and I came to your rescue. I got you out of it. And likewise, how many days have we called our Father? And Perry, he keeps getting us out of one situation after another. He keeps getting us out of one situation out of another. He keeps listening to our lies. I'll do everything you said that we should do. But as soon as the forecast was clear, they reverted back to their old ways and did what they had always been doing. Yet I hear God saying to Jeremiah, and it's fulfilled in the book of Hebrews, Jeremiah, tell my people, I made an agreement with them. I made a covenant with them at Sinai. And they promised to keep my word. But as soon as the contrary wind stopped, they went back to doing what they had done before. But Jeremiah, tell them I love them so much that I'm going to give them a new covenant. The old covenant was written on stone. This one I'm going to write on their hearts. I'm going to renew my relationship with them. They will be my people and I will be their God. And I will remember their sins no more. Pastor, what is God saying to us in July of 2021? Though you have defaulted, and God says, I can't forget this, I was a husband to you. That's Bible. I was a husband to you, but you let me down. But I'm still going to love you through this. I'm still going to love you in spite of your sinful ways. I love the Lord. Psalm 116 says, because he heard my voice and my supplications. It's prayer time. Before we have prayer, I want to open the doors of the church. I ask that those who watch it online, please stay with us, because I just believe God is going to liberate someone. If you're unsaved today and have not accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, come. Pastor, I failed on all of my agreements. I just keep making agreement after agreement. And I just keep falling short. If you know what I mean, will you raise your hand? If you've ever experienced what I mean, would you raise your hand? But yet, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thine hand has provided. I'm not going to name a number because I didn't hear a number. But I just want somebody to celebrate that God has established a new relationship with you. It's prayer time. It's prayer time. It's prayer time. Right where you stand. Can I tell you something you can do? You can whisper a prayer. And sometimes you just got to admit, Lord, I've been wrong. Thank you for granting me another opportunity. Thank you for having mercy on us. Thank you for not giving us what we deserve. The Old Testament says, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. The truth is, when we broke your law, you could have dismissed us. Deacon Poe, if you move on to the mic and lead us in prayer. But rather than dismissing us, you gave us another chance. Somebody ought to say thank you.
Thank you, God.
Didn't do everything I was supposed to do. In fact, I did a lot of the things you told us not to do. But you gave us another chance. I'll write my law on your hearts this time. I'll renew my relationship with you. You'll be my people, and I will still be your God. And I will remember your sins no more. I feel it. I feel it. Down in my soul. Because you don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. Your grace and your mercy brought me through. I'm living
this moment
yes, God. Because of you.
Amen.
Your grace
yes, God.
And your mercy brought me through. And I will make a new covenant because you broke the last one.
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for the word on today. Lord, as we come before you, humble as we know how, Lord, I thank you and praise God for planting a seed and planting an anointing on this pastor to bring forth this word that burned our hearts. Lord, we thank you for reminding us of the covenant breakers and the covenant keepers. Lord, we thank you that you're not manny, that you don't treat us the way we deserve, Lord, but you give us grace and mercy every day. Lord, I thank you for the picture that he painted, that we are constantly breaking our contractual agreement with you. We're breaking our covenant with you, Lord. But not only do you look beyond our faults and see our needs, you grant us a new covenant every day. And Lord, not only do you give us that new covenant, you give us some bonus benefits, Lord. Lord, we thank you for the word that you're putting in our hearts. Lord, we thank you for establishing that new relationship. Lord, even though we constantly fall short, Lord, we ask that you be with us, Lord. Lord, we ask that you put in our hearts the desire to be bold and live for you, Lord. We pray that you give us the strength to do your will and not our will, Lord. And in those moments when we're sinking, Lord, and we're far from the peace of shore, we ask that you and we thank that you continue to bring us back in, Lord. Lord, Lord, we know we don't do right. Lord, we know we mess up time and time and time and time again. But thank God for your grace and mercy. Thank God for establishing relationship with us. Lord, thank God for your gentle hand. Lord, you're our husband and we broke the vow. Lord, you are our father and we consistently mess up. Lord, but we thank you and praise you for who you are. Lord, you obligate yourself to do just what you say. Lord, and we want to have that same desire to do just what we say. Lord, we want to love you. We want to feel you. We want to see you. We want to walk in your path, Lord. But we know sometimes it gets hard. And Lord, we got to remind ourselves who we need to call on. We got to call on our Father. Our Father constantly comes and bails us out of trouble. We got to call on our Father. Our Father constantly comes and see about our needs. Lord, we got to call on our Father. Our Father continues to take care of us. Lord, we got to call on you. And Lord, in those moments that we can't see you, when we can't seem to trace you, we got to continue to trust you. That word that you put in our heart pulls us out of danger. That word you put in our hearts pulls us out of uncomfortable situations. That word that you put in our hearts allows us to minister to those who have not heard your word. But that's good news this morning, Lord. And we thank God for the gift of Jesus Christ that you provided for us. Because we know with him you established that new covenant. And this new covenant we pray and we hope to live by. Lord, give us the strength. Give us the desire. Give us the will to do your will. Lord, I ask right now that you touch those who are in need, Lord. Lift them up. Prop them up on every fallen leading side. Those who have lost loved ones this week, Lord, we ask that you continue to touch them. Lord, we pray that your peace and comfort and strength be upon them. Those who are in the sick room, Lord, we ask that you continue to lay your healing hand. Those of us who have forgot about your word, we ask that you remind us that you are a promise keeper. Morning by morning, new mercies we see, Lord, and sometimes we take that for granted, Lord.
Yes.
Lord, let us not take, you're not a God that just a wishy-washy God. You're a God that is faithful to the end. Nothing can separate us from you, nor height, nor depth, not even death. Lord, we ask that you continue to press upon our hearts to do what we need to do. Lord, we thank you and we honor you on this day that the word that we heard today has changed our hearts and changed our minds. And we'll always be reminded that you don't remember our past sins. You let it go. And Lord, I pray that you give me that gift to let old stuff go. Stop dredging up the past. Stop holding against those. If I call myself a believer, because God, I have to love with you love if I call myself your child. And I know you love your people, Lord. So I pray that we continue to lift each other in prayer. That we rejoice in everyone's celebration. And that we empathize with those sorrows. And Lord, we ask these blessings in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Before I dismiss you, well, before we end the live feed, I sit there and I am always sensitive to the Spirit. And God said, Terry, remind them that father had worked on an 8-hour job and then drove 3 hours. Deacon Jenkins, back in the day, if I had driven that distance, and found out that it was only because the car had given out of gas. Whew. I would have said, stupid, I would have. How in the world can you be driving a vehicle and not paying attention to the gas meter? The father in this story didn't make any accusations, didn't rebuke his son. He just says, get in it, put some gas in it, and go home. Pastor, is that it? No. He said to him, this will always be between us. Good God from Zion. I won't bring it up to embarrass you. God said, I will remember your sins no more. I won't bring it back up. I won't throw it in your face. I won't wash your face with it. I will remember your sins no more. Behold, I will make a new covenant. Write my word in your hearts. Renew my relationship with you. And again, remember your sins no more. a covenant-making and a covenant-keeping God. For those of you who join us on Facebook, we are signing off. May God bless you, and may you have a prosperous day, and may you be reminded of God's mercy. Amen.
Amen.
And amen.